Is liberty dying where you live? Escape to Keene at freekeene.com.
So finally, the public hearing, it was worth waiting for. House Bill 1697, welcome Representative Hunt.
Good afternoon.
Yes, Phil.
And I realize that this is the last bill for a very long day for you, so I will try to be a model of brevity.
Good luck with that.
I would say that this is the first time I've ever been in this committee room. I don't know too much about how you all operate in transportation. I would say that this bill is not perfect yet, and you will hear from some from the insurance department and some other people who will tell you that we need to do a little tweaking for the language to make sure that it all syncs correctly with our current auto insurance law. Having said that, I'll give you a basic outline of what we're trying to do here, and then you can decide whether you like this or not. All of you have probably heard of Uber and Lyft, right? Yes, you do. Okay. So, Uber's, you know, I'm going to say Uber because they're the ones who are most, obviously, number one in the business. Lyft is coming up, but I'm going to talk about them because they're the ones you read about most in the papers, you've read about in Portsmouth. So they're, you've heard of them, so you probably have a vague idea what the issues were, which was the background checks. Okay. So I was on a study committee along with your chairman, and in which we delve into the issues of this nature of this transportation system. I don't know how we call it, the technical term. And to really understand what the issues were and what the pushback is. Now, notwithstanding that anybody who owns a taxi medallion, who spent money to get the medallion, and I don't know if you're, and I know you use transportation, but I always like to compare it to liquor laws, because that we know in commerce, that there are some states that literally limit how many liquor licenses they give to a town. And they think that you know, certain, based on your population, you should only have so many bars in town. And they literally, the only way, if you were opening a restaurant, the only way you could get a liquor license is that you had to go buy somebody else's license. Okay? Because if all were already issued in the town. We call that medallions. All right? And it's the way the legislative term. So many cities have medallions. They literally limited how many taxi drivers you can have in a town. And clearly, if you shell out money for one of those medallions, Uber is going to be the most sinful, out of this world idea you could ever imagine, because it totally undermines that value of that medallion. Okay, that exclusive right that you had is gone. So, needless to say, the Portsmouth cab company was not too excited about the idea that Uber was operating in their community, and the city of Portsmouth actually threw the medallions in the trash can. They actually walked away from it and said, okay, we're not going to worry about that. But they did hold on to this one issue, which is the background check of the driver. All right. Now, I was a taxi driver in my past life, and Ed Butler, was also on the committee. And we were all joking, it's not the taxi drivers you need the background check, and it's the passengers. They're the ones that are holding you up. They're the ones who are getting in the car. That's why in New York you get all these plastic, plexiglass. It's not to keep the driver away from you. It's the passenger. So it would seem ironic that we're going to get hung up on this idea of background checks of the drivers. Notwithstanding, we did delve into it, and what we discovered is do not confuse what we do by our state law requiring nurses and teachers to have a background check to get their license renewed. Because in those cases, you go down to the Department of Safety and they will mail your check to the board themselves directly. They do not provide that service for taxi drivers. So if you were going to go to enforcement and get a taxi license, you would theoretically go down to the Department of Safety, pay your $10, I assume it's still the same price, and get your felony, your background, and it's never, I don't do mental health, all we do is you have a felonies, And you can take that and you walk that over and you hand it to the city of Portsmouth. That means you walk there, you the taxi driver, you're the one who just supposedly this is all about you, are hand delivering it. Now come on, that is not what we call a secure system. So once the committee realized that's a little flaky, and you're starting to say this, where you know we're going to hang our hat on maintaining taxi drivers, and we're going to try to run Uber out of the state over this issue, it seemed like we were on very tender ground. Then you match this up to what we have here in front of us. And this is model legislation that's going across the country. 25 some states have already passed it. And basically, what we're going to try to say is that, yes, we absolutely have expectations about these drivers. And we want to hold them up to a very high standard of safety and making sure you don't do drugs or alcohol, that we're going to have high expectations that should be higher or better than just getting this felony, having you hand delivery or felony report to us. So the Department of Safety will collect one license from the company. So that means Lyft or Uber or whatever the company is, there's one license. Not every driver's license, only one license by the company. And that company now has to have certain standards, and they have to document what their safety standards are, that they have a requirement that they're going to hold their drivers to the highest standard, and that if at any point in time a driver is a problem, obviously the Department of Safety will notify Uber or Lyft or wherever the company is. And if that becomes a problem and it becomes the Department of Safety is thinking that the company is not holding these drivers up to a high standard, they'll yank their license. And now we don't have to worry about the local police pulling over Uber drivers. Now we'll have the state troopers pulling over. Okay? Because if they lose that license, that means they cannot operate in the state whatsoever. So theoretically, this is a much higher standard. This is going to be much more, expectations are going to be for Uber or for whatever company is doing it, they're going to have a lot on the line, just like a $10,000 license. There's going to be a lot on the line, and they have to uphold it, and they have to maintain these high standards. For those of you who are familiar with it, obviously, they have a better system than we have for taxi drivers if you had a bad taxi driver. And the best I know is you could put a letter in the newspaper and letter to the editor and say, I had a bad taxi driver, but who knows how many people actually use newspapers anymore. In Uber, that driver, you can tag that driver. And if you get out of that car and you thought you had a bad experience, you enter in right in, and that driver has got that hanging over their head forever. So security and safety really is not the issue, but we're taking it as a responsibility for us in the legislature, and we're going to have to address this issue. But more importantly, and this is the bottom line, and that is that it's not about one municipality or this municipality, that. Because you can't. You know, how many drivers are going to only go stay in Portsmouth when you get picked up? They're going to go to Newington. They're going to go to somewhere else. They're going to go across state line. They're going to go somewhere else. So we can't think about, taxi medallions should all be about Portsmouth. They're all about these individual cities. This is a time for we, the state, need to step in and have a regulation to ensure that this new means of transportation, which clearly for the next generation, this is all they know. I mean, they don't even know that yellow cabs exist, unless they go to New York. So this is the way of the future, and this is a great opportunity for us, the state, to do something about it. So now you realize I was probably longer than I should have said.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Representative Hunt. So if I haven't read the bill yet,
yes.
I didn't have the time. If I understand your testimony here, this would level the playing field for all entities that offer a ride.
Definitely a very level playing field, yes.
Thank you.
Representative Sykes.
I may have missed it. I just read the bill again and quickly read the bill again. I understand that you are trying to make insurance coverage, for instance, be required, which is a really good step.
Yes.
What I didn't see, is there any part of this that requires reporting the inspection status of the vehicle that you're driving?
The terms of, I know for Uber that they require the car to be, it has to be less than 6 years old.
Yes, but okay. Still.
I would venture to say if you've ever been in a cab that was less than 6 years old, you're a luckier man than I am. Most of the cabs I've been into seem a little tired. But in terms of the safety standards, I mean, I have to admit I don't know that detail. But I do know that Department of Safety is the regulator of this. Theoretically, they'll know the car. They will know the drivers who are registered. They will be notified who they are in public and what their cars are.
So I guess, is it a fair assumption then that it would be possible for an Uber driver to have an uninspected vehicle, and the only way that would be discovered would be if it was stopped?
I would prefer you ask that question to someone who knows the dog with better detail.
Thank you, Representative.
I would never venture to that say.
Further questions? Representative Bourne.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your testimony, sir, and for taking my question. As I understand it, there hasn't been situations where our constituents have been harmed by these network companies. This bill is in response to an outdated mode of public transportation that hasn't kept up with the changing time.
We're not throwing taxi guys under the bus, okay? They can still continue to do what they do. Nothing's changed their business model. Ironically, they're actually adopting some of this business model. Okay. The important thing is that we're taking this new business model and we are taking an assertive step to make sure that it can be done statewide in a uniform fashion.
Would you agree, sir, that the innovation representing Uber was only possible because they had the freedom to establish that business model, and that other companies are going to be cautious about coming to this state or starting up in this state if we enact legislation that is burdensome to business?
And I would say to you that we made very carefully that this legislation as drawn by Uber, now maybe Uber's trying to undermine competition, and maybe that's why they chose the $10,000 license. We figured that the Department of Safety is going to have time and effort to put in here. I can't imagine more than a handful of companies doing this, so we definitely want them to have enough money to make it, to get the Department of Safety to fund whatever they're going to have to fund to make it work. But I would not say that this is that is anti-business. If there's a new business model, I'll be the first one to come in and tweak it to introduce a new business model. But I can tell you this. This is, those companies want this legislation. Because what they don't want is what's happening right now in Portsmouth, which is that Portsmouth is pulling over Uber drivers. Little old ladies. I read the paper correctly.
Representative Cardin. And we've had Representative Hunt up there for quite a while.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is quick.
No shortage of more people to question.
This is real quick. Do present taxi cab drivers have to undergo a background check? Then will Uber drivers undergo a background check?
The Uber drivers have to go through a background check through Uber. So Uber has their own McDonald's secret formula of what they do for background checks.
Okay.
The only background checks that a taxi driver has is if the taxi company, if this town they're in, requires them to deliver that felony report. But if the taxi company has nothing to do with it.
Thank you.
Further questions? Thank you, Representative.
Just one. If I remember life insurance situation, you were covered, double indemnified, if you were in an accident involving a recognized public transportation. Does this now recognize Uber as public?
$1 million policy. If you're inside an Uber car, the policy of that driver is not covering that. If you're an Uber passenger, there's an Uber $1 million policy following you around.
If I can actually answer Representative O'Brien's question. Most insurance policies have double indemnity on transportation, not public transportation. That's why I've always told my wife, if I do something awful outside, put me in my truck and roll it down the bank.
I should
I'm sure that there could be specific policies to public, but most policies are just simply modes of transportation.
I'm on the right side of the lawn. I haven't looked at my policy lately.
All right, thank you, Representative.
Thank you.
Senator Donna Susie, and support of the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. For the record, I'm Donna Susie, representing Senate District 18, which is Manchester, Wards 5 through 9, in the lovely town of Litchfield. I will be brief because I know you have lots of other folks to hear from. I did want to answer one of the questions that was asked earlier, though, regarding the need to have proof of registration. If you turn to page 6 of the bill, starting on line 5, the individuals acting as drivers have to meet certain criteria, and one of them is demonstrate that their car has in fact been registered. So that, and that's on line 14, Representative. But let me just say, Representative Hunt, I'm sorry I wasn't here for the beginning of testimony, but I chaired the study committee on ride sharing this summer. We spent a great deal of time and really heard from a lot of different people with very different points of view regarding ride sharing. And there were certain things that came across as being very important. To the extent ride sharing exists in our state, we want to ensure that there is a mechanism in place to screen drivers so that they are safe. We also want to ensure that there is an insurance requirement, hence the language you have here, which is in fact not our language as sponsors, but is model language. And you'll hear more from the insurance industry. They were helpful in bringing that issue forward. But the thing that was most challenging was recognizing that there is an existing regulatory scheme in place at the local level for taxi cabs. The fact is that it is 2016, and many of those taxi cab ordinances were enacted probably before I was born, and have been around for a while. That doesn't make them bad, but it makes them different, and it makes them cumbersome and burdensome. What we did find is that there are communities around the country that have embraced ride sharing that still maintain taxi cab companies. And as someone who travels a fair amount, I can tell you, communities that have vibrant ride sharing activity tend to have better taxi cab quality and better service. The taxi cabs are cleaner, and the businesses are competing with the ride sharing opportunity. That is a concern, I think, in some of our local municipalities here in Manchester. The taxi cab companies offer a service. They do, in some cases, offer a service that's different than what the ride sharing service is offering. The ride sharing services, although can be accessed by people of any age, tend to be accessed by people who are younger, live in more urban settings, and have an expectation that that service will be there for them. And as a state that we know is aging, and that is trying to bring people either back to the state after they've gotten an education or get younger people to move in, we need to be cognizant of that. And we can't send out a message of being welcoming and embracing if we're not willing to look at different types of technologies that are offered around the country and that provide a very, very valuable service. This legislation isn't to do away with taxi cab services. This legislation is to add another opportunity, another product for people to avail themselves. I think that by having the Department of Safety license these entities, it means that they can coexist. We are not taking anything away from any municipality that currently regulates taxi cabs. They will continue to regulate taxi cabs. What we're trying to do is come up with a more uniform system to deal with the issue of ride sharing. Because as I said, it's a service that has taken off, it's innovative, and in a state that prides itself on the opportunities it avails its citizens of, it's something that we should find a way to accommodate and to embrace. There are other folks here that are going to talk more specifically to some of the technical aspects of the bill, but I will conclude my testimony with that, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Representative Gannon.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Senator. Welcome.
Thank you.
The fly in the ointment seems to me that Uber and Lyft can charge whatever they want, I think. And the taxi cabs, I know in Manchester, are regulated by the municipality as to how much they can charge per tenth of a mile, whatever it is. So how do we reconcile one with the other? It seems like the taxi cabs are hamstrung. They have to do what the municipality says they have to charge for the rate. And the others, it doesn't seem like even competition to me.
Good point, Representative Dagny. There are different schemes for pricing. There is somebody who represents Uber, who I think will speak later, and can probably speak specifically to how they determine their pricing, because it does run a little different. What I would say, though, after spending a great deal of time this summer looking at the issue, is that imposing greater restrictions on ride sharing isn't necessarily the answer, but I believe the communities should lessen some of the burdens on taxi cab drivers. Taxi cab drivers have a place, as I said, they offer a service that they offer it all the time. They are located within our communities. They offer service for sometimes transporting goods if paid to do so, doctor's appointments, other things. I don't want to take that away, but I honestly think that some of our local regulations are more burdensome on taxi cabs than they need to be, and perhaps we could ask our municipalities to lessen some of those so that they can compete on a more level playing field. But I think the legislation is suitable to regulate ride sharing, but I don't think further limiting the ability to charge is the answer.
Well, we agree. Thank you.
Representative Sykes?
No, I'm going to I'll wait for the, did I hear you say there's an Uber representative?
Yes.
I'll ask the question of that person instead. Thank you.
Representative O'Brien.
Thank you. Senator, you come from Manchester, I come from Nashua. Do you think this will prohibit any home rule of how, like, I agree with you in your statement that maybe we ought to redress the issue with the existing taxi system and, you know, get out of the fingers in the pot, so to say. But does this bill stop home rule on Uber or the other carrier?
What it does is create more uniformity by providing a state regulation. I would say, as a representative and me as a senator, I don't think we want to get into the regulating taxi cabs further than they are, but I think as an alderman, you might be able to do something in Nashua. No, I really think that the regulation with respect to taxi cabs is properly with the local municipalities, and there are going to be discrepancies. I think that the examples of Manchester and Portsmouth show that we have not been able to embrace and understand and adjust the ordinances to accept the technology. So it's better placed with the Department of Safety.
I would like to thank the Senator for recognizing the delicacy of the matter for the Alderman. Thank you.
For the record, I believe we are a Dillon's rule state, not a home rule state. Representative Horn. And again, this whole pile, getting through it before we leave. Continue.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Senator, for your testimony. You mentioned that the taxi cabs, this was drafted in with the taxi cab service in mind. There is another avenue consumers in New Hampshire have when it comes to hiring services to get them to and from places, and that's the livery industry. Was the livery industry stakeholders in drafting this legislation, or do we just pretend they don't exist?
I don't want to say we don't pretend anyone exists. The committee was certainly open to any comment, critique, participation from any industry. I don't think anyone ever came forward. But I would be happy to leave. I'm sure the chair has a copy of the report, and I can provide a copy as well to the committee, which lists every participant and every person who testified before our study.
Further questions? All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Senator Martha Fuller-Clark.
Thank you very much, Representative Smith and members of the committee. For the record, I'm Senator Martha Fuller Clark. I represent District 21, which consists of the city of Portsmouth and the six surrounding communities of Newfields, Newmarket, Newington, Madbury, Durham, and Lee. and I appear before you today as a co-sponsor to House Bill 1697, and also as one of the original sponsor to have the state look at this issue and to have created the committee that went ahead to study this bill. I would recommend to any of you the minutes from the committee study, which are online. I think it will give you a lot more in-depth background to the issues that are being heard. I think it's interesting that we really are dealing with the issue of what is the power of a municipality to regulate and the power of the state to regulate. And if you were to look at state statutes that had to do with the issue of taxi cab service in New Hampshire, the only law on the books related to taxi cab services is it requires that those businesses must have insurance. Every other regulation around taxi cab services is handled at the municipal level. So when Uber began to be a dominant presence, and currently Uber is in Portsmouth, Manchester, and Nashua, will it begin to reach out into other smaller communities? I've always thought it should go to Hampton because Hampton doesn't have a taxi cab service and they have huge transportation issues, but they decide where they're going to go, where they think there's going to be enough business to be able to make it worth their while. So then there did suddenly become this issue, and it really took Portsmouth and a little bit later in Manchester, that was, how was this impacting on the existing taxi cab businesses and services? And feeling that there was a very unlevel playing field, that local municipalities were requiring taxi cab businesses and individuals who drove taxi cabs to meet certain regulations and requirements that were put in place by the municipality. And that was the only way that they could get a medallion. You can think of the medallion being like a license, but at the local level. Now, we know that in New York City, if you want to drive a cab, you have to be part of an entity that has purchased a medallion, and those medallions are worth millions of dollars, because the purpose of having a medallion was to make sure that you didn't oversaturate the market so that we could be assured that there would be public transportation available in the means of individual transportation through a taxi cab business. And if there were too many, then all those businesses might collapse, and you and I as consumers wouldn't have access to any kind of alternative paid for private transportation. Of course, the model, as you've heard, for Uber is very different. And one of the problems that we started to run into in New Hampshire was that each of these three major municipalities were struggling with how to find that balance, but between what they should regulate Uber to do and what they, or the other ride-sharing companies, and what they were already regulating municipalities to do, plus the fact that these ride-sharing businesses tend to move in a much larger circumference. Most of your taxi cab businesses within that given community and perhaps the very adjacent communities. But Uber may take you to Boston, or it may take you to New York City, or, you know, so in a way, having municipal regulations over a type of business that was really engaged in a number of different municipalities sort of was problematical as well. So what happened in Portsmouth was that in an effort to make it more competitive, the city of Portsmouth did away with the medallion requirement, so that they would supposedly have more of a level playing field. But what we heard from people, the ride-sharing businesses, was they were still having to negotiate these issues on a community-to-community basis. And frankly, they see this as being pro-business because it's one license at the state. They know what the requirements are, and they can negotiate that and agree to meet those requirements if they wish to bring Uber into the state. That's not anti-Uber, and it's creating a much more consistent path for them to follow and should allow them to be able to function in any community without having to have go through this sort of tension between the taxi cab business and these ride sharing businesses. It seemed I support this legislation. I think it has achieved an appropriate balance. It is requiring for the company to provide the background checks. It's requiring for the company to provide the overall insurance that will protect both the driver and the passenger. Those are really essentially the two primary requirements in order. It says here on page 12, line 13, no person shall operate a, here it's called a TNC, you know, these network, transportation network companies in New Hampshire, without having first obtained a permit. It says here from the department, you know, that's the Department of Safety. And so then it goes through what the Department of Safety shall require in order for that permit to be granted. So I would urge you, there may need to be some tweaking that you're going to hear from, but I would urge you that if we really want to support these types of new businesses, these peer-to-peer businesses, that passing this legislation is the right thing to do. So, and we still left the issue of municipalities and how they should deal with the taxi businesses. And I think they're going to see that they're going to have to loosen up and change. Now, we know in Portsmouth what happened was that all the taxi drivers got their own app so that they could compete with Uber. So they're saying, yeah, we need to move into the 21st century.
Senator, you're approaching about double your requested time.
I'm sorry, I had a limited time. Well, I'll shut up right now.
Well, I'm trying to hold people to their agreements. So,
okay.
Because we traditionally end up being an hour behind schedule.
And
totally
I understand that as well, and I apologize. But I hope I've been able to put this into an overall context and speak on behalf of my community and on behalf of Uber. So thank you very much, and I won't answer any questions.
She's my new favorite. And for those of you who have requested 5 minutes, if you've been watching the faces of the committee, I might suggest that anything you think is really important say in the first two, because at this time of day you're losing them after that. It's just how it is. So, next up, Mr. Freeman.
So I have mixed feelings about this legislation, and I hopefully won't offend the panel. I apologize about that earlier. Mixed feelings because on one hand, I'm actually an Uber driver, so I've done a little bit of Uber driving in my time. And I think that one of the concerns that that people who are in the ride-sharing business have is that there's all these different towns, and all the different towns have different requirements for being legal, and so therefore Uber might just say, well, forget this, you know, if we have to jump through 300 different hoops in order to do business, we're just going to leave New Hampshire. So from the perspective of this would set one set of rules for the entire state, that makes sense. But I think that on the other hand, I think the best solution for a level playing field, somebody used those terms earlier, the best solution for a level playing field would be to get the government out of regulating transportation services entirely and to further prohibit the towns and the cities from regulating taxis and Uber and ride sharers. That's a true level playing field because it's an open free market. And it's sad that in the live free or die state, people have to beg for permission from the government in order to be able to take someone from point A to point B. So ultimately, I think the best solution would be to repeal all the transportation regulations and prohibit the individual towns from confusing the matter by making different ones. I don't know how many of you are familiar with what's been going on out in Portsmouth with their crackdown against some of the Uber drivers there. Has everyone heard of the Uber grandma situation? She's been ticketed now and is facing $3,500 in fines because she's taken people from point A to point B. She's taken drunk people home, you know, on New Year's Eve or whatever, and she's been pulled over four times by Portsmouth police. She's 64 years old, she's a former school bus driver, and now she's facing $3,500 in fines because of this. And it's really showing the government to be this tyrannical organization. They're cracking down on an old lady who's trying to make a little bit of extra money, you know, nights and weekends. And I think that you're going to see more of that as more regulations come into place on this business. But yet the technology industry changes faster than the government does. And so what you're going to see happening is there's a new startup that's being created here in New Hampshire called Arcade City. And Arcade City is going to be decentralizing ride sharing even further than it currently is. Right now, Uber is this sort of mega corporation who helps connect passengers with drivers. Arcade City is not going to have a corporation behind it. It's just going to be a program. How do you find a program? How do you, you know, get a $10,000 fee from a program? So ultimately, the marketplace is going to continue innovating beyond the government's capacity to regulate it. So I think that, you know, people on the streets know that ultimately what the government has done, or what some of the taxi companies want, is for the government to protect them from competition. Now, I've heard some pro-competition statements from some of the speakers so far, and I think that that's a good thing. But ultimately, people on the streets know that these taxi companies are protected. That's what regulations do. They don't actually protect consumers. They protect the long-standing industry interests, the people who've been in business for a long time. And I get it. They jump through the government hoops, and they feel like it's not fair. Well, we've been jumping through these government hoops for decades, and then there's this new company that comes on the scene, and they haven't jumped through any of the hoops. So, of course, the people who've been jumping through the hoops want to force the other people to jump through the same hoops. I'm saying get rid of the hoops. Let people make their own decisions about who they trust to take them places. It was mentioned that Uber has a system in place to regulate, to sort of self-regulate. Whenever you finish a ride, I recommend everyone take a ride in Uber and see what it's like, because you get to rate the driver. And if the driver's rating goes below a 4.6, they get cut off. And that's 4.6 stars out of 5 stars. So there are no 3-star Uber drivers. They will cut them off of the system. And so I think the system works fine on its own. Uber's got commercial insurance already. You know, they don't need to be mandated or told what to do. That's just prudent business. So those are my thoughts. Thanks for listening.
I'm confused. On your card, it says you support the bill.
I put a question mark there because I just...
He doesn't know how to apply your testimony for our records. Do you support or oppose the bill?
I'm middle of the ground. I'm not going to take a position because I.
So after 5 minutes, you have no position.
Well, I like I said, you know, there's some things that I think are okay about it. I like the idea that they're standardizing.
You don't oppose it, so you have no position.
Neutral.
Those are your three options.
I'm neutral about it. I'll say that. I think that the bill should repeal all the transportation orders.
That is not the bill before us today. Thank you. Questions from the committee? All right. To head off further speculation about what Uber may or may not say, Mr. Merrill.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Jim Merrill from the Bernstein Insure Group. I'm here representing Uber. I've got a letter here for you. I'm not sure if I have it for everybody, but some reading material after the fact here for you. I'll keep it brief. I know we're at the end of the day and the hour is late, but I want to say up front that on behalf of Uber, we do support this legislation. We believe it's necessary primarily to avoid a patchwork quilt of regulations at the municipal level that would make it difficult, if not impossible, for Uber to do business in New Hampshire. This is legislation that we've seen passed over 25 other states, and I won't get into the details of how Uber works. The letter explains that in some detail, but this is the product, as you know, of a study committee that we took part in over the last year. And I want to say, Mr. Chairman, I know you were involved in that, and for Representative Hunt and Senator Susie and others who were involved, we're grateful to them for their efforts and their diligence in looking at this issue. And there was a comment that came up earlier about the recommendations of the committee, and the recommendations were twofold, as I recall. Number one was to pass legislation that's before you today. Number two was to encourage municipalities to review their taxi regulations and to make them more competitive and more streamlined in the 21st century. So what's before you today is something that Uber supports, and we'd encourage your support and happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. That's got to be a new record. So, yes, Representative Crawford.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a quick question. On your fees, do you notify the people who are going for the ride that you charge more on special occasions like New Year's Eve and things like that? Because my daughter got caught in Denver and didn't realize that when she was going to take her Uber ride to get home, that they charged her credit card an exorbitant amount of money.
So to answer your question, the way the Uber pricing works, and the letter reflects this in part, but it's not necessarily pegged to a special occasion, but it's a matter of supply and demand. Uber's rates go up when demand is high and there aren't enough drivers on the road to fill that demand. The price goes up because that increases the money payable to the driver. That encourages more drivers to get onto the system. So to answer your specific question, before any rider gets in a car, when you request an Uber on your phone using the app, you request an Uber, it will show you the fee. So you, at that time, have the opportunity, before you get into the car, to choose whether to accept that ride or not. So it shows you in real time what the fee is, and then you're able to accept it or not accept it based on the decision you make at that time.
I guess she wasn't paying attention.
Or they didn't tell her. Or they didn't tell her. And don't feel bad. I can't tell you how many technology professionals I work with that say, well, I don't know what's going on with this. So what happened? Well, it was a pop-up, but I made it go away. Made it go away. And yeah, well, I clicked it. We're quite happy. Further questions?
Thank you.
Nope.
Amazing. Okay.
Just a point of order. Not all of us got his written testimony.
Yeah,
I wonder if you could, through the chair, can it be provided to
we'll
out in an email?
Absolutely.
Thanks.
Yes, sir.
Actually, do you have an electronic copy of it?
I'll send it along. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, just email it to me. I'll make sure that they all get it.
Happy to do it.
For a public hearing, said no. We are not taking any action, so no quorum is required.
Upstanding.
I wish you hadn't asked me that question, because as long as some of you believe the quorum was necessary, we can keep the room full.
Mr. Chairman, if I might just real quickly.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much. George Russo's representative, I had to step out, I couldn't be here. You heard Representative Hunt talk about a few minor tweaks that we're looking for in the bill that's before you on the insurance side.
Yes.
And he'll follow up with you on that, but just to be clear, Uber and AIA are on the same page here. We support the minor tweaks on the insurance side together, and we'll share that with you in due course, but.
Okay. And, no, you're not. So, the amendment.
Yes.
Is that coming, or is it something I should be doing?
Well, you know, the question was posed to me, and I said, you know, each committee does things differently, and the last I heard from this, the reputation of this committee, was that you would like me to sponsor to have the amendment drawn up.
That would make me so happy.
But I would tell you, we would never do that in Commerce.
I'm the king of delegation, so.
Commerce, we own the bill.
Yeah.
We actually tell the sponsor, go away, don't worry about it.
No, it happens now and then, but that's like, so it's already gone through this process. It makes sense.
I absolutely will have a finished product amendment that will have all the terms issues addressed for it.
Okay, and this one's an FN, so can we get it in 2 weeks?
It's not that it's an FN. It is, the FN just simply means the Department of Safety did a fiscal note for you. Now, with this, this bill is an early bill, so you must have it out of committee by February 4th at the latest.
Yes, our last day is February 2nd to act on it.
There
so,
you go. I will have it to you. I expected to have everything done next week. I think we're very close. It's just minor tweaking in the language. So I would hope to have a memo for you next week.
Fabulous. All right. Any further questions? Yes.
Yes. There is no fiscal impact.
I'm sorry?
There is no fiscal impact on the bill.
Really?
Yes. Due to time constraints,
there's no doubt.
to just figure out if we like the policy, and that can be the next committee. And after the second committee, it still has to go to finance. So there's going to be three swings on this.
No, it would go, you know, the next committee will go to would be, I'm assuming, I have not looked at it, assuming it's going to go to criminal justice because of the Department of Safety piece to it.
Okay, but if there is fiscal impact, it's still going to finance.
No, only if it has an A on it. That would be an appropriation. If it has FM, really? It does not necessarily go to finance.
All right.
Sorry, I don't mean to be...
Well, there's at least one more swing at it.
But yes, it will definitely go to something else.
All right.
Are we
done with Mr. Merrill, who's sitting there patiently wondering if he's on the... All right, I guess so. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Mr. McLaughlin, and support of the bill.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman. My name is Mike Favazzo. I'm the local counsel for the Property Casualty Insurance Association, and I brought some documentation in support of the bill. Well, they're all the same thing, but it's... Again, Mr. Chairman, Mike McLaughlin, local counsel for the Property Casualty Insurance Association, as well as the counsel for all state insurance. We support the bill. We work closely with the companies to solve the insurance issues. You've heard all afternoon the clash between the personal property, the personal automobile policy and the Uber policy, and at certain points of time there was a divergence between who actually had the coverage. The bill actually puts together the proper structure so that when a person has contracted for an Uber ride, that person is going to have the coverage that they deserve and the safety that they can get. So what you have in the bill is the National Council of Insurance Commissioners version of the insurance regulations that will make sure that there are no gaps in coverage. When an Uber driver picks somebody up, there will be coverage in place. When the Uber driver is not working for Uber, his personal automobile policy will cover him at the same time. So those little gray areas were worked on through the summer. As was mentioned by Mr. Merrill moments ago, there are some issues in the bill that need a little tweaking. In the copy of the bill that I handed out today, there's one paragraph that we put in red that is our edit. We'll make sure Representative Hunt gets that, and we'll happily be back when it's done. But the other materials I gave you are background materials. The Council of Insurance Commissioners, their document, PCI's outline, and the what's happened throughout the rest of the country. And I think that's the minute.
Nice.
Questions, Mr. McLaughlin? Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Next up, David Weeks, in opposition to the bill.
Yes, everyone knows where I am from before. I represent DNB Taxi and Courier Service and Concord Cab Company. Just a few things. I have no axe to grind whatsoever. Uber can't compete with our prices anyway, but what I'm concerned about is the level playing field. Okay? I pay approximately $30,000 to $40,000 a year in regulation fees. I pay $150,000 a year for insurance. And I feel I'm paying my dues. But I did a little experiment with Uber in Manchester in December. And I went down there and I stayed at a hotel and I called the app, did the app, and they sent a driver, supposedly. Never showed up. I waited 2 hours, he still didn't show up. Okay? So I moved to a different hotel and I called again and they send a driver, and I had to wait outside, incidentally, and he pulled up, and I went to get in his car, and I asked him how much the fare was, because I'd already been quoted a fare by the app, which was $18. He couldn't speak English at all. Didn't speak a word of English. I couldn't communicate with him. Okay? Another occasion, I called Uber again from another hotel in Manchester. The driver came, I got in his cab, and he had a bottle of beer between his legs. Okay? Needless to say, I didn't go far with that. And the final one, I again called Uber, and they sent a cab, a vehicle, not a cab, was not marked, no marking, no credentials inside, nothing. And I got in and I said, what is the fare? He said, it's $27 and plus my tip. I says, well, the act quoted me $18, why is it 27? He says, that's my charge for the fare. Pay to get out. I got out. Okay? That was my experience with Uber. Portsmouth, I have cabs all over New England. We cover the New England area and Eastern Canada. We do medical transportation also. Our cabs are clearly marked. We sent a cab over to Portsmouth to pick up some people. The police stopped us and he says, what are you doing in Portsmouth? And we pulled out our orders from the insurance company and handed it to him. He said, he said, okay, you guys aren't even doing cab work over here. I said, no, we don't go into somebody else's town to do cab work. It's unethical. Okay, so they're not just picking out Uber, they're checking everybody in Portsmouth. Okay, and our drivers go through a rigorous procedure. Criminal background check, motor vehicle background checks, drug testing, okay? They all have to go through that before we will even hire them as a driver. We had a gentleman, they came in and applied for a job, and we told him, you gotta go get your motor vehicle records, and you gotta go get your criminal background check, you bring them back here. I will read them, and if it's okay, we'll send you for your drug test. What drug test? He said, I said, you have to take a drug test to drive for us, our company. Well, he went and got his motor vehicle records checked and brought them back, and he had 6 pages of violations. Needless to say, he didn't get a job driving cab. He went directly from us to Manchester, and he's now working for Uber in Manchester, driving a cab, driving a vehicle. I'm not going to mention names, I know who he is, I know where he operates out of, but this is what's going on with this whole situation. It's very, very bad. It's seriously bad. The public is not being protected by anyone. If legislators are allowed to go through, we're going to be dealing with a bunch of people here that do not know how to transport people, and it's going to be some serious issues, especially with elderly people. Okay? Because elderly people don't understand what's going on. So, I guess with that said, the other thing, I asked the guy that came with the bottle of beer, I said, can I see your insurance card? And he says, he didn't have one, obviously, because he couldn't show up to me. Didn't have one in his vehicle at all. We know they're driving around with no insurance. We know this because we've done studies to find it out. Okay?
Representative Gannon.
Okay, all this anecdotal evidence.
I'm sorry, say it again.
All this evidence that you brought forth about Uber,
mm-hmm.
right? They're all anti-Uber. Did you report this back to Uber? Because I understood in some of the testimony.
Who do you report it to?
Well, taxi commission.
Who?
To the app.
To the app. I don't know. I'll never ride in those.
Oh, cars. Yeah. They did. There was feedback going back to the app. If that's what you're saying. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I mean. You know,
yeah. It was reported back. Every incident was reported.
And you heard nothing back?
Never got an answer from nobody.
Okay. Thank you.
Further questions? All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Dennis. And then there were two.
Dennis Acton and Superintendent Bell.
Good evening, I'll make this quick. My name is Dennis Acton from Fremont, New Hampshire. I'm one of the senior Uber drivers down the Seacoast, and a little bit disturbed by the preposterous claims I just heard, but we'll move on from that. I like where we're going with this bill. Obviously, Uber drivers don't want to have to register in every single town. That's why it's going Dover now. I was talking about it. Hooksett, Manchester. I work all these towns, sometimes even in one night getting called around. We take this job very seriously. I'm in touch. We have a close Facebook group of about 25 drivers on the Seacoast. We're setting up training courses. I myself have actually practiced with a person in a wheelchair transferring in and out of my car. I know all the side streets. I know every hotel in town. I know what's going on in the city. We are ambassadors of the city to the visitors and people that we take around town. One thing we look forward to out of this legislation, and I am in favor, obviously, with this. I do have some recommendations. Certainly establishing controlling authority at the state level is something that we all probably agree that needs to be done. The one thing I do worry about is as far as creating the TNC in this $5,000 figure, in essence, shutting down small business. Myself, in my ideal situation, I drive a luxury Mercedes SUV. I would prefer to be my own sole proprietor, to be able to choose from a variety of insurance products that for the amount of driving I do, whether it may be just on the weekends, which I have been doing, or maybe I go up full time. I want to be able to have that capability. If I have to pay a $5,000 fee, that's I can't do it. So if there would be some way to create a way for small business to take part in, because I believe that Uber has come in and disrupted things and done a great job, but it will decentralize at a certain point where I can work on my own or in some way as a small business. Certainly the key here is getting conditions where insurance companies will come in and offer products to us. In Massachusetts, you can get an add-on to your personal insurance. There's at some point Uber Black will be starting, which is the next step up from Uber X, where the driver actually has to have a certain type of luxury vehicle and has to have some kind of livery insurance. All of these things will be happening in this state eventually. We want to make sure that we don't start micromanaging too much, where if I drive as a TNC, I can't also, through my livery insurance, do custom rides as a limo service as well. So it's like interoperability between the different classes of transportation companies. And ultimately, just be careful about taking a snapshot of where the industry is now and creating regulations around that. And by the time it gets implemented, we've moved beyond that and we're obsolete. That's the biggest worry. So a lot of the information in here as far as requiring how you give your, the operational things and how you give your receipts and how you charge, I don't think that's anything that's necessary. I'd like to see this bill reduced down to dealing with insurance at certain levels, and then letting innovation of New Hampshire small business people take it from there, and then ultimately the riders decide. All right. Any questions?
Questions from the committee? All right.
Thank you.
Next up, Wardell Johnson in opposition to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Cordell Johnston, and I represent the New Hampshire Municipal Association. And we do have concerns about the bill, and the concern basically is that it completely preempts municipal regulation of what is fundamentally a taxi company. I keep hearing that we need this legislation because current regulations don't fit Uber's business model. I have not heard anything that explains why Uber cannot comply with the local regulations that already exist. What I've heard is that they don't want to be subject to what was called a patchwork of local regulations. That's an occupational hazard, unfortunately. There are plenty of national companies in other areas that have had to deal with a patchwork of local regulations. If you think about McDonald's or Walmart or whoever has to deal with local zoning ordinances, site plan regulations, health codes, etc. The business model that we keep hearing about, it's different from that of a traditional taxi cab. It's not that much different. You contact someone, you pay for a ride, they take you somewhere. That's a taxi cab. If you look at the definition of taxi cab in RSA 3140, I think it is, it clearly covers something like Uber. So There may be changes that ought to be made, but I think you ought to go slowly. Just because a big national company comes and says, we don't want to have to deal with municipal regulations, I don't think you should just roll over and say, okay, or it's not you rolling over, it's the legislature rolling over the municipalities and saying, we're going to do this to accommodate this company. I think municipalities have a legitimate interest in knowing who is picking up passengers and driving them around, and a legitimate interest in the safety and the economic well-being of those passengers. So, as I say, there may be changes that need to be made, but I do think that a complete preemption of municipal authority is a little hasty. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions from the committee? All right. Mike Skelton, support of the bill.
You know how fast that can change.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. For the record, my name is Mike Skelton. I'm the president and CEO of the Greater Manchester Chamber of Commerce, and here in support of the bill. I'll try to be brief and touch on some points that have not already been raised. We're strongly in support of this legislation and think it is absolutely the right direction that we should proceed in with this issue. I think there can be more discussion about the technical aspects of the bill, but what I wanted to focus in on are two things. First, we've had some discussion about, is this the right type of regulation? Is this the right approach for regulation? And I think it is. And it's not often, I think, that you'll have a pro-business organization like a Chamber of Commerce come into a meeting room like this and be in support of creating a new regulatory structure. But we are here today for that, because our perspective is that creating this new regulatory structure will actually be good for the free market and be good for consumer choice. Our concern in Manchester, and I think other organizations like us and other stakeholders that see this service of value, our concern is that if we don't solve this problem, if we don't put in place fair and reasonable and logical regulations for this type of service, it may not be here permanently. And that would be a very bad thing for the state of New Hampshire, be bad for our communities. I can tell you that it may not seem like a big deal, but having Uber in Manchester and communities across New Hampshire is a very good thing for our economy. It is a very good thing for our business community. I meet all the time with companies that I'm trying to get to relocate and expand to New Hampshire. And many of the companies that I represent in my chamber are right now in a war for talent. They're trying to attract people to New Hampshire to work here. And ride sharing and having companies like Uber in New Hampshire is absolutely a check mark in our column to help sell this place. It's a good place to live, a good place to do business, a place that's thriving, a place that's home to technology. So I think we need to take this very seriously. I really view the stakes are high on this issue, that if we don't get this right and we lose out on this amenity, there will be consequences for our local economy. With respect of is the regulatory structure right at the local level or the state level, I respectfully disagree that this is something that is akin to taxi services. Vehicle for hire services have the regulations have been in place for decades. The business models are fundamentally different. I don't want to get into that discussion necessarily today because I don't think we have the time, and there are oodles and oodles of resources and papers and white papers out there that explain why these business models are very different and why the regulatory structures need to be very different. I'd be happy to come back and talk to the committee anytime about that. But this is not simply a black or white issue of regulating one company as another business model just because we think it looks the same. The amount of technology that goes into ride sharing vastly far surpasses anything that is available in current vehicle for hire services, and thus makes their business model is fundamentally different. Lastly, I just wanted to comment on the experience that we've had in Manchester. Uber has been in Manchester for close to a year and a half now. And as a Chamber of Commerce, when something happens in our community, if there's some sort of issue, a complaint, I have to say a great deal of it comes to our doors. We hear about it. We have not had any negative complaints about Uber. To the contrary, we've heard very positive things. Our young people, our student body, I have members of my board of directors who are the presidents of local banks who are taking Uber. This is something that everyone has appreciated, has come to the community, and is truly viewed as a strong, strong amenity that we need to keep. So with due respect of folks who have heard things, seen things, experienced things, I can just tell you from our organization that represents 900 businesses and an awful lot of people who do business and many stakeholders in the city, we have not had any safety issues or complaints with Uber. And we're pleased to see this legislation come forward because it will only strengthen and ensure that we protect against any measures or issues like that coming up in the future. And I know I'm running up on time, but one last thing. Just our experience thus far in Manchester was very much focused on the background check issue. So I appreciate that this legislation, I believe, is presenting a solution that will address that issue, which was the major stumbling block we kept running up against with some early discussions in Manchester.
Representative Johnson.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you very much for taking my question. As I listen to all of you, there's a couple of people that I heard say that they would really like to see it be more helpful for the smaller businesses. As the CEO of the Chamber of Commerce, do you see that as being a workable possibility within the ramifications?
Yeah, and certainly this could be clarified, but I believe in the legislation, the license fee, the $5,000 fee, I could be wrong, but my understanding is a transportation network company like Uber would get licensed by that, would pursue the licensing at the state level. It's not like every Uber driver would have to go out and seek and pay that licensing fee. That's my understanding. So as an Uber driver, you just have to go through the process to apply online and become and go through their steps, which again, we don't want to get into right now because it's pretty complicated, but is very rigorous from all the analysis and study that I've done. And the folks who I have talked to who are Uber drivers, I've taken dozens of Uber rides in Manchester and in all over the country. And the folks who I generally talk to is they're supplementing income. They are small business people. There was a gentleman who gave me a ride in Manchester who had his own small business, a graphic design studio, and he did Uber driving to supplement his income and to help keep his business going. So I very much think ride sharing is supportive of small business.
Thank you very much.
Further questions? All right, thank you. Let's see if I get this one right. George Russo's.
Yeah, George, I believe, and that's actually...
Yeah, that's why I referenced George in my comments, so, okay. Yeah.
So we're good?
Yes.
All right. Then, Sally McFadden. Taking no position on the bill.
We are not taking a position. We feel that many of the items in the bill... our policy decision best left up to. I'm sorry, Sally McFadden. I represent the New Hampshire Insurance Department. I'm an actuary at the New Hampshire Insurance Department, and thank you for hearing my testimony. Many of the policy items in the bill we think are best left to the legislature. That said, we think that the insurance section of the bill does a good job of resolving the issues that have been spoken about in the industry. The reason I'm up here is simply to. Ask for the committee's indulgence in giving us a little bit of time to finish drafting an amendment that we think will address some of the technical items that are in the bill right now. They're mostly just to make sure that the language meshes well with current personal auto law.
3 weeks.
Yes, we have already spoken to the sponsor about this, and we will be getting the language to him at the beginning of next week.
Yeah, I'm
yes.
Not trying to be a jerk, but when we get close to the second, my back is going to be up against the wall, and, you know.
Yes, we've made a commitment to Representative Hunt to have him the language.
Sounds good.
Within a week.
All right.
And
that's it. Oh, what a nice way to end. Any questions? All right. Is anyone else wishing to be heard on House Bill 1697? Seeing none.
close the hearing on House Bill 1697.
To invite you to visit freekeene.com. Freekeene.com features audio, video, and blogs chronicling the transition to a voluntary society. Freekeene.com also has comments and discussion forums so you can be heard. Freekeene.com.
I should be in Keene, New Hampshire with the Free Staters.